And now, the bonfire.
Comes a guitar. Here comes the drums. What's up, everybody? We're back. Hope you had a good weekend. It's the bonfire. Faction Talk, Sirius XM 103, Big J Okerson and Robert Kelly. Big J is out. Lou just held up a sign like a homeless person with the writing so big on it because old blind Bob, blind and stupid Bob with a learning disability can't read 12-point Helvetica.
You're welcome.
Yes, thank you very much, Lou. I appreciate you treating me like the boomer that I am. Jay is out of the studio today, and that song was dedicated to him. Since you've been gone, Jay, we miss you. But in the studio is one of my favorite people on the planet, Joe DeRosa.
Yep.
Joey Roses.
Good to see you.
Buddy, I am happy to see you. I'm so happy to see you.
I'm very happy to see you.
Yeah, I mean, your face doesn't express that.
I have so many.
Your face expresses like you just found like some type of fungus on your foot.
I have so many gripes with already since I've been here with you.
I'm so happy, dude.
I know, but I came in, giving me like pointers.
I didn't give you any pointers.
And I've hosted the show more than you have.
Understood. I did not. Here's a problem. Here's the problem with you. Can I tell you the problem with you?
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead. Tell me.
You just, like, we have this thing that we're going to talk about. I found this thing. I can't wait to get into it with you. And you just start yapping. And it's hilarious. And I'm like, dude, just shut up for 3 minutes.
It's fine. We're going to be good. You're so excited today.
I'm excited.
Because Jay's not here. You'll be able to get a word out.
First of all,
you thought I couldn't redo it. I said it off air. I brought it back. It worked again.
First of all, I don't like that. My big teddy bear is out of town right now. He's got a big couple weeks. He's He's out promoting a special, man.
Oh, that's great.
He's got his new special, Dog Belly, and it's April 5th, and it's going to be on youtube.com/@BigJOkerson.
That's
so
awesome.
It is free. And it's hilarious. It was produced by the great Rabbi Ari Shafir, Mazel Tov. So make sure you check that out. And but I am excited that you're here because my
I'm sorry.
Go ahead. You saw him this weekend. You went to his Beacon, right?
I went to his Beacon show. This is what a psycho Ari is. I'm like, dude, I'll be there Friday. I promise. It's going to be awesome. I'm just coming to hang. Like, I can't wait to support you. I'm so excited.
Yeah.
He's like, dude, that's great. Whatever. He got Joey Rose's sandwiches, which was very cool of him.
You brought them?
He ordered like a catering order.
Oh, that's
really
great.
Yeah, it was very sweet.
Because you didn't bring any here, right? You brought a bag. You thought you were bringing a bag?
No, I never said that.
You didn't bring sandwiches?
No.
I asked you if you could bring some sandwiches.
Yeah, there's this number you can call and have them delivered.
What the fuck? Oh, thanks, Lou. Just dropped a bag of Doritos, a mini trick-or-treat say. Oh, and literally two
Single Oreos.
Single Oreos. That's great.
That is horrible. Could you imagine if somebody put a single wrapped Oreo in your Halloween bag? I would hit the person with my bag. No, but I go, I'm not kidding, dude. At 6 p.m., the show's at 8. At 6 p.m., my kitchen, the pipe under my sink in my kitchen burst. And there was water all over my kitchen. And I'm like, oh, my God. And I'm like mopping it up. I'm calling the landlord. They sent somebody right over, which was great. But it's a disaster. Like, you know, you have to tend to it immediately. I text him at 6:15. I go, brother, I love you. I will be there, but I might not make it by showtime. A pipe just burst in my kitchen, and I'm like frantically trying to get it cleaned up. But I will see you tonight, I promise. And he goes, do you want to go on? And I go,
what?
Dude, the show's in like an hour. What are you talking? And he's like, yeah, I forgot to, should I ask you sooner? I wanted to ask if you wanted to go on. I go, yeah, dude, I do want to go on, but I'm not kidding. Like, the pipe, like, it's like, so I will try to get there. I think I can be there by 8:15. He goes, it's plenty of time. Don't worry. And that's how he books his openers, apparently.
Yeah, well, listen, I mean, it doesn't surprise me.
And I went on at the Beacon Theater.
That's great, but it doesn't surprise me. I mean, the guy's done, you know, more mushrooms than most goats have been eating mushrooms. I mean, he's smart, but he's not adjusted well.
No.
So how was it? Was it packed?
It was awesome. It was packed. It was really, there was a lot of love in the air. He put the opening of the show was awesome.
What was the opening of the show?
He had like a dance troupe come out and dance. And then he like appeared on stage with this spot. Like he came out and like the background was all pitch black and he came out and they played Simon Says, bum, 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 get the fuck up. And a spotlight went on and he was just on stage and everybody went crazy.
Wow.
And then he brought out all the secret openers. So he brought out List. Then he brought out me. Then he brought out Schultz.
At the beginning.
Yeah, and he was doing time between everybody. And then he did like an hour and 10 at the end and killed. It was fucking amazing.
So he put on a show.
He did.
Oh, good for him. If I got the Beacon, I would have just went out with Scopo and Gomez. Or to Kelly Festuca. Hello?
Yeah.
Just bomb in front of me. I mean, there would be no fanfare, no music before anybody. What kind of dance troupe? Where do you get a dance troupe? I always wanted to get a dance troupe for something.
One of them was, I think she's the coach of it, was Jade from The Stand, one of the managers at The Stand.
Like a dance troupe? Like, what do you mean? What kind of dance?
Like hip-hop-y, I guess. You were there, right, Evans?
Yeah. It was great. It was such a great show. But Jade's dance, she did like more of a sexy thing that I saw her in last time down at The Stand. This was like more campy, I want to say. But what was it? Maybe like eight girls came out and did a whole routine together to... It was a really
what
campy song.
Was it again?
I think it was a shake, 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 Sonora, shake your body.
But was it
the Beetlejuice song?
But was it like a high school, like when you go to see your kid type?
No, they were.
No,
little,
she's
no,
like
they're great dancers.
Great, okay.
she's here to dance. Okay. Like she moved to New York to dance, so this stands like her day job.
I've known Jade for 3 years from The Stand.
Yeah, and
I see her in a whole new light now that I saw her dance. I was like, oh my God, this gift you have that I had no idea. Like, it was that, they were that good.
So now you're going to try to have sex with her?
No.
Oh,
Jesus
God. Well, I didn't know. You saw her in a new light. Maybe you didn't want to bang her. Now you want to bang her.
I see you in a new light. I don't want to have sex with you.
Come on. No. Come on.
Out loud, I don't.
Yeah, exactly.
By the way, I made notes.
First of all, if you take a sip of water on that microphone again, I'm going to throw up.
What are you talking
about? You took a Mr. Radio guy, Mr. Dude, I've been doing everything. I've done this more than I'm a radio. You took a big, this is what I heard when you were
It's coffee. It's not water.
Whatever it is. It almost made me puke. It sounded like Patrice breathing in his last moments. Sorry, that was terrible. I apologize.
I was just going to make an awful joke. All right. You by the way, you scolded me before we started because I called you Bob, and then you referred to yourself in the third person as Bob.
I can do that. You've never called me Bob in my life, and then you were nonchalantly talking to people going, yeah, Bob.
You look like a Bob now.
What the fuck does that mean?
You look like a Bob now.
I don't know how to take that.
You look like an actor doing the panel. At the movie.
You look like a Janine.
It's not an insult, you fucking psycho.
I feel like Bob is an insult.
It's like you've got like the actory glasses on.
This is sounding insulty.
It looks like when Bob De Niro sits down and they're like, so Bob, what was it like on the set of Mean Streets?
You call me De Niro, I'm back in.
Yeah, there you go.
I feel like something's coming though. You're writing something down and then you just
crossing out the bits I already did. Your positive energy. You're very positive.
I'm very happy right now. I'm very happy. The family is great. I feel fantastic.
The Bonfire family or the personal family?
My personal family.
I don't know. I don't know what you meant.
What do you think? I'm going to put the fucking... I just met these guys Tuesday. This guy's already holding up old age signs. Jacob tried to attack me last week.
You meant the Bonfire family?
No, I do. I mean, my new Bonfire family, I was excited to come in today. I haven't seen them. I was excited when I woke up today to come into the studio, like to see everybody. I got here an hour and a half early.
Why?
I don't know why. I got here too early because Jay usually makes the hey, we'll meet out front. Or Christine will say, we'll meet out front. Yeah. And it wasn't that because Jay's not here.
Yeah. Jay's been pitching me that for years. I've never done it.
Well, I usually do it.
Jay's like, we'll show up at 4:50. Let's call it 3:45.
Yeah.
You watch me smoke 6 cigarettes. It'll be good. I'm like, nah, I'm fine. I'll see you at about 5:02.
I like it. Me and Jay go to the Starbucks together. Yeah. We take a little walk.
It's nice.
And I showed up and nobody came out. It was me smoking a cigar up front by my. And I put it in the text thread. Anybody want Starbucks? Everybody just went, no, we're good. And I was like, I got money. Like, I'm paying.
There's a great, have you been to this place downstairs? The one like in the building?
I have. It's
very good.
It's really good, but it's a little too good for me.
It's a little expensive. It's a little foofy.
You're a foofy guy. You like the foof.
Sometimes. In certain things I do, but not in most things I don't. Like I like dirty bars. I like disgusting women.
They like disgusting men.
Yeah, they like disgusting men.
No, you're a foof guy. Even the fact that you like the dirty bar, I consider foof.
No, because I liked it before it was like a thing.
Yeah. Listen, I'm not saying you're not the originator of the foof, but you're definitely in the foof, okay? You went to the dirty bar because it was foofy. It's like, dude, let's go to the dirty bar instead of the fucking cool bar. And then we wind up at a place with a bunch of anchor tattoo guys.
No, it's...
Yeah. They had a dartboard. I remember. I used to go.
I like a no-frills bar. It was my favorite monologue I ever wrote at the Pete Holmes show when I worked there. Take it easy.
I don't like that you just dropped it down.
No,
I was a writer.
I pitched the monologue. My favorite thing I ever pitched and got to write was Old Man Bars was the monologue. And it was about those bars.
Yeah.
And my favorite joke in it was the people that don't get it come in and they're like, are there any games? Like, yeah, stare in the mirror and drink. Like, I have this like a bar where it's like, we're here to get some work done.
Yeah.
Know what I mean?
There's a game. There's a game, just commit suicide in the bathroom.
Exactly.
Hey, it's called Go Pee on the Ice.
Yes.
Why, you don't like a nice golden tea in a bar? You don't like golden tea?
Golden tea is an acceptable bar arcade game.
It's one of the best games ever.
We have an arcade game in my bar. You know, there's acceptable arcade
games. Where's your arcade game?
We have Star Wars arcade in my bar.
Oh, yeah. I love your bar.
Thank you.
I do. I went there twice.
Thank you.
And both times you ignored me.
That's not true.
It's very
That's
close
so
to true.
Not true.
It might not be true, but it's close to true.
No, the first time you came, you was to do the podcast.
Sure.
And I would talk to you the whole time because I had to. Because it was a podcast.
Well, there you go.
The second time you came, you were nursing Keith. You had your hands full.
Oh, is he taxing? I love him to death, but Jesus, I wish I got the Comedy Express, Keith. I got the Comedy Not Express.
I know. I wish I got the not funny, fully functioning Keith. Instead, I got the funniest version, needs help, Keith.
Yeah. I mean, we went all the way over to your bar, in between spots at the Cellar. And we get all the way over there in the Uber. And the Uber was, look, man, we got the Uber and his leg, you know, we had to like kind of jam his leg in. Mm-hmm. And I felt like I was going to break it.
Yeah.
You know, and he's laughing the whole time because he's just laughing at this guy.
He's sick.
He's crazy.
He thinks it's like funny.
He thinks it's hilarious that the Uber driver had to push his legs into the Toyota Corolla. And I was like scared that he was going to snap his leg off. And
oh my God, I just choked on coffee.
But then we went to your bar and we're like, first of all, it's me and Keith.
Yeah.
We were there when you came. We were the ones who called you No Shoulders Joe the first time.
It's weird. Why would you bring that up?
I mean,
that's not the name of the bar. You're making it sound like you're like.
It should have been the name of your bar, by the way. Instead of Joey Rose's No Shoulders Joe.
Well, but I named it. Never mind. Go ahead.
But anyways, we show up and we're like, we're expecting you as soon as you to see us to hey, you may a little more fanfare, a little more oomph.
You showed up on our first anniversary. It was our first anniversary party.
Sure.
At 1 a.m.
Yeah.
Do you know how much I had imbibed at that point? Like the amount of shots I had done at that point in celebration of we made it to a year.
Okay, that's great. But yeah. You were talking to some guy like you were going over fucking script notes. Like you had a movie going starting.
Might have been.
And we showed you, hey guys, how you doing?
That's you're full of shit. I gave you a big hello. You're full of
you
shit.
You show me the hello you think you gave
us. I was like, oh, you made it. Yeah.
100% not.
That's bullshit.
100% not.
That's bullshit.
100%.
Also,
100%.
You know what steps on a good hello?
What?
Keith going, fuck you. You know that's how he opens the conversation.
You got a point. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
That is, he really did. He really did just go, fuck you, DeRosa.
Yeah.
I mean, that does put a damper. And everybody around doesn't know. And they're just like, who is this old black guy telling the man of the hour, go fuck yourself?
They thought a hospital patient had escaped. And come into the bar.
And one of the local homeless people came in and go, you fucking stink.
We should call him. Can we get him on the phone?
No, we called him last week and it's too difficult. I had a call up, set up a nurse thing. We had to make sure he ate before. Plus, all he does is goes, huh? What?
Oh, God, man. Yeah. He's an interesting guy. He's an interesting guy.
He is.
You know, he's still.
We have interesting friends, dude. I mean, think about how long we've been hanging out. I mean, me and you. Let's just throw it on the table, Joe. Let's throw it on the table. I mean, we started all this. I mean, me and you.
Radio. We started.
Not radio.
Podcasting.
We started afternoon radio, Joe.
You and me and Burr.
What?
You.
No, not Burr. No. No.
Well, remember doing. But actually, it's because you showed it to me. Yeah, you and I. I remember doing podcasts with you on that phone service.
Me and you used to do.
We had to call it. Remember?
We had to call it, but then me and you started doing. I started with Colin Quinn, but he hated it so much he just would never do it. Yeah. And then me and you started doing it, and then me and you upgraded to an actual little mini board into my computer, right?
Yeah.
And we would do it at my house. I remember I bought all my equipment off of Todd Lynn.
Oh,
it was the worst. He robbed me so bad. He walked up, hey, Bobby, I got all this podcast equipment. You want to buy it?
As he held a water behind his back with his tiny hand.
I forgot.
Remember that? Remember he had a tiny arm and he would like hold it back here to hide it?
Jesus Christ, Joe.
What? Like he was a pitcher setting up a fucking fastball?
I forgot about Todd Lynn's tiny arm.
Yeah.
Why, was it a time? Did it not grow, or did it was an
it
accident?
It just was smaller. I don't remember why. It wasn't that noticeable, but it was like a smaller arm.
Yeah, but he had to like hold a pencil in it while he was on stage, right?
He could have been the meanest person I ever knew in comedy. And he got nice to me at one point.
There it is, holding the mic. The one, yeah. The third one in, that's it's holding the mic. Yeah. It is a small little hand.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
He got nice to me in the later years.
Yeah, because he was dying. That usually happens when people are dying.
He's blind.
Yeah, he was blind.
I met him. He was nice.
Yeah. Oh, God, I'm such a load.
What do you mean you're a load?
I caught a picture of myself in the...
I think you look good, dude.
I started my weight loss journey this week. Oh, that's what I want to talk to you about, your weight loss journey.
Oh, thank you very much.
But hold on a second.
Yeah. What do you mean?
Todd Lynn gave me the best insult I ever had, ever. I told the story at the Patrice benefit. I go, this insult is so good it trumped even Patrice's best insult.
What is it?
Todd Lynn was blind in the airport. He came walking up to the gate with two canes, and he heard me, and he goes, ugh, is that DeRosa's awful voice I hear? And I go, Jesus Christ, Todd, with all you're going through, I'd think you would have become a nicer guy. And yeah. He goes, just because I'm blind, don't think you can't offend my other senses. I was like, Jesus Christ.
That's a good
that could
one.
Be the greatest slam I've ever heard.
And then he died.
And then he
which
died.
Which is perfect. Right.
Terrible. Good night. Yeah, they.
Oh, but we started this stuff. I remember me and you did the thing.
Yes.
And then we brought Danny down. You brought Danny down. You're like, I got this friend of mine. Let's bring him down.
Bugs me still.
Why?
Because look what he did.
Yeah. I
could have shut the door on Dan Soder.
Yeah, you could have.
And instead I opened it.
You opened it wide. And the first time we had him on, I was so like, this kid is awesome.
And you know what Dan did to thank me?
What?
As soon as he got an opportunity to do a radio show that paid money.
Yeah.
Hey, Jay, do you want to do a show
with me? Well,
I mean, these fucking cocksuckers, they got no gratitude,
yeah,
none of them.
But we're here now.
Yeah, exactly. I'm in your seat, Dan, you cocksucker.
I'm in a seat.
All right, fine. I'm in Jay's, I'm in somebody's seat. I was giving you Jay's seat today.
Oh, thanks. I tell you what, we switched seats. Jay switched over to this seat, and I switched over to that seat.
Right.
I hate that seat. Christine, I'm telling you right now, that seat has...
Why?
It has energy. It kills me.
You hate it?
I hate it.
What do you hate about it?
I don't know. There's something evil. I think it's my back is towards the door.
I hate that I can't see...
Jay?
The person that's there. Yeah, Jay, I mean, cues on him, but now even you, I'm like, oh, I wish I had a better...
I hate... It makes me feel
bad. I'll tell you the worst seat. That one.
Why? Jacob's seat?
It's fine if you're producing. I've sat in that seat when they've had too many people on the show and they got to put the third guy there or fourth guy even there.
Right.
That seat sucks.
Yeah,
if it's like when you sit at the head of the dinner table, it doesn't feel right.
Well, because
it's like you're out of the mix.
Because I'm a man and I have a family and I'm a dad and a husband, sitting at the head of the table feels good to me.
And a chauvinist that you won't let anybody else sit at the head.
100%. Fuck, cook the dinner, you sit on the side, to the right of me, right of the father.
That's so funny.
Why? Where would you sit? If you had a dinner table and a wife and a child, where would you sit?
I feel like I'd mix it up every night.
Nah, you wouldn't.
I will tell you where I'd sit.
Yeah.
I like a three. When I visit my parents, it's a three top seating.
Yeah.
So three of us. We do two on one side, one on the other. I like facing each other. I don't like the person at the end of the table unless it needs to be there. I feel like you're out of the mix. It's weird.
I sit at the head of the table where you should sit. And when we have company over Thanksgiving, we have a bunch of people, I get one head of the table, and then the other alpha male gets the other head. And that's it. And everybody else is on the side where you should be. If something goes down, the two alpha males are facing each other. We know what's going on.
Okay.
And we go, let's go.
All right.
Okay? Yeah, if you were at my house for Thanksgiving dinner, you would sit to the left of me.
What do you anticipate going down?
You never know. You never know. Nowadays, it's crazy. Have you heard all these podcasts? It's good. There's conspiracies. China's coming. The Russians are coming.
So wait a second.
I'm with you, Bobby.
But yeah,
I'm with you. I'm with you about where you sit. I couldn't sit there.
A big surprise. The guy that went to knife camp also thinks something's going to go down at Thanksgiving.
Yeah, you have to know. You have to be able to keep your eye on the door. Know when the enemy is entering.
Yeah.
You got to know. You got to know when the. And I know where the knives are, by the way, because I would love to go to knife camp. By the way, I looked into it. I might be going to that this summer, Jacob. Oh. So yeah.
Yeah.
I have knives all over the house in certain areas.
Jacob's Thanksgiving table, they all pass the blood of the turkey around first so that its soul can be in you.
They eat the innards first?
Yeah. Was it a clean kill? But wait, so yes, we
hang on. I want to ask Lou, where would you sit if you're at the table with your family? Where would you sit?
Whatever's open, does not matter to me.
Really?
I don't think anything's gonna happen. I don't need to watch the door.
Yeah, but you
gotta check your corners.
You gotta check. Listen, here's the thing: you gotta check your corners.
Lou would see whatever the widest chair was.
Oh, that's because of his beautiful ass. You're right.
All right, sorry. Don't hit me. Don't hit me. I'm just joking.
I can't believe you still remember that.
Don't get mad. I'm just joking around.
He's got a nice bum. Right. Lou, where would you sit?
When we have a lot of people over, I don't sit at the head either.
What, when you're home, you don't sit at the head of the table?
No, we have a large table. This is just annoying.
This is what's wrong with America.
Evans, where would Jay have you sit? I'm kidding.
My friend said that she actually like entertains and does dinner parties with her, well, now ex-husband, but she said they would actually both sit at the heads of the table.
Yes.
She's like, we entertain in different ways. So when they would have people over, they wouldn't sit next to each other.
I like what you just said. I like when the couple whose house it is, each of them sits at a head.
Listen,
I like that a lot.
You can't do it. If you got kids, you can't do that. If I got, you got, listen. When we have a party, we have one of those extending tables too, right? And you'd love it. It's from the 50s. So we extend the table depending on how many people are there. I sit on one side. Whoever the other person is, the other guy, will sit on the other end. And my wife and the girls will sit with the kids on the side to keep them, you know, because they got to cut the stuff up and stuff like that.
Oh my God.
Dude, listen, that's what's wrong with this country, because guys like you sit on the sides, okay? Men need to go back to the top of the table.
The fact that you
thank you
think
that's right.
I'm a good example of a sensitive man is you're in trouble.
Listen.
If I'm who you're saying is too sensitive, you're in trouble.
Well, you're not sensitive verbally, but if something goes down, you're not the guy I'm going to. If we're at my house and something goes down, you think I'm going to hand you a weapon and go, let's go, Joe?
Who are you going to hand it to, Verzi?
I'll hand it to Dawn. Dawn will cut some throats.
So get her at the other head.
All right. Well, maybe if you were there, I'd put her at the other end.
Let's talk about the queefs that you would have at your dinner table for a holiday from this business.
Let's go.
Paul Verzi.
I've had Paul. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Italian guy. Yeah, Greek Italian. I definitely have him. Psycho. Oh,
no. You think he could handle a weapon?
All right. You got a point. You got a point. I'll give you that 1 point. Let me write it down. Let me use my pen. You're using your pens. Crossing off your little bits. I'm going to use my pen. 1 point. I didn't know we were writing
Giannis,
shit down.
Giannis Pappas.
Yeah, but okay. Maybe not Giannis, but if he has the wig, he gets into Mauricia, and that Puerto Rican will fuck somebody up. Oh, that's it. So there you go. There you go. That's my point. 1-1. What else you got?
Who else? I'm trying to think who else you've had. I know who else you've had to your house.
Yeah.
Rosebud and Andy Haynes.
I would not.
That's a double void right there.
Well, Rosebud's fucking psycho. I'm not fucking
actually. I got to tell you, I would give Rosebud like an automatic rifle.
I would not give her any weapon because she'll use it just if nothing goes down. Yeah. If Andy says the wrong thing and gets out of line, she'll use it.
Did you ever see the clips of them when they start fighting on their podcast?
No.
It's like,
oh, where is that?
It's uncomfortable a little bit. Yeah.
She is.
She'll get a look on her face where she is so disgusted.
Yeah, I know.
It's like, Jesus but Christ.
She's got an energy around her, though. Like, her energy is very alpha.
She's
like,
great.
She bitched me out.
Oh, yeah?
Like a month ago.
About what?
She was on Instagram, and she had sweatpants on, these weird sweatpants that she was kind of holding out so you can read them on the thing, and I sent her a thing, your sweatpants infuriate me. And she sent me a text back, I'm not in the fucking mood, Bobby, fuck you. Enough with this bullshit. And I was like, hey.
Yeah, yeah.
I apologize.
Keith calls her Bride of Chucky.
Yeah, she's, dude, I do not fuck with Rosebud anymore. Last thing I want to do is getting beaten up by a rich white girl that used to date black dudes. Oh, yeah.
She went out with, what's his name, forever.
Yeah. What's his name? Yeah, that sucks that we can't remember his name.
Blanking on his name. Seton.
That's why she dumped him. We can't remember who he is.
No, Seton's a good dude.
He's a great guy. He's very funny.
And then Andy also has Andy's got a blank stare on his face.
Yeah, that's because he hasn't eaten meat in months.
Yeah, I know.
His blood sugar's low.
He had the funniest response when he got sober. I go, I saw him at a party, and I go, no, he's talked about it publicly.
I
saw him at a party,
yeah.
And I go, what's up, dude? You want a beer or something? And he's like, nah, man, I quit drinking, quit smoking weed. I'm sober.
And I go, what made you quit? And he goes, because everything was going really well, Joe. Like, all right, yeah. Asshole. Jesus Christ.
He has really good, like, English wit.
Yeah.
He really is. I love Andy.
Yeah. He does look like he writes poems.
He does.
Like, real poems.
Yeah, he's very gaunt.
Yeah. Yeah, I think Rosebud doesn't let him eat. He keeps food from him.
Yeah, I think Rosebud hits him.
All right. So far from your guest list.
Okay, I had...
You got a girl that could use a rifle that you're afraid to give it to.
True.
And a guy that if you put into a wig and a dress might be a threat.
Yep. Okay. Louis C.K. came last year. How's that?
He's going to have his hands full.
Wow. I mean, yes, he's a friend of mine. I mean,
he's a friend of mine. It's a funny joke to make. I think he would laugh about it I think so. Right?
Yeah, maybe. Or fucking hang himself. I mean,
not hang himself, scarf himself.
Woo! All right, one for you.
I wouldn't make that joke if I think he wouldn't.
If he was here and asked you to go on tour with him.
If he was here, I would say, yeah, could I just open for you?
All right, so I got.
So wait, but Louis, you think Louis is going to handle a fucking weapon? Are you nuts?
I think Louis.
Are you nuts?
I think 100% Louis. You don't think Louis? First of all, he's half Mexican.
Oh, come on.
So maybe not a gun, but definitely a knife.
No, dude, you're nuts.
Louis boxes. Louis's a fighter, dude.
You're nuts with
I
that.
I swear to God.
First of all, let's get the record straight about boxing, about these guys that box.
Yeah.
All right?
Yeah. You seem angry about this. I box.
Yeah. My partner at Joey Rose's owns a stand.
Sure.
He does this, too. He'll be like, I'll call him. I'll be like, let's meet today at 1. He's like, I can't. I'm training.
Yeah.
You're not getting ready for a fight, Paul.
Okay.
You're a fat guy that a guy teaches how to hit a bag. Everybody is doing this thing where they're like, yeah, I train. I box. No, you don't. You put on boxing gloves and hit a thing that doesn't hit you back.
I'm going to tell you right now.
That is not boxing.
I'm going to tell you right now.
Go ahead.
I will beat the shit out of you in boxing if Maroon 5 payphone is playing. You're dead. Maroon payphone's playing in the back. I will beat the shit out of
now
you.
Now, let me tell you who's at my Thanksgiving.
Wait a minute. I'm not done.
Oh, all right.
I got more.
Louis, I love him, but no. He's not firing a gun.
I had Mike Calta was at my home.
Calta?
Calta at the head of the table. Me on one side, him on the other.
Let me tell you what happened if a home invasion happened with Cal.
First of all, go ahead.
You would be screaming, barricade the door. Everybody would going to be barricade the door. You would turn around and you would see Mike picking food off of people's plates.
That is a really mean. I mean, that is just mean. That's fat shaming, and I won't stand for it.
But is it also accurate? Tell me if it's accurate.
Well, it depends. If the stuffing was on his end, maybe yes.
Like something ran out?
Yeah, something ran out. If the dark meat was going on? No. Dude, my Calta has 95 guns.
All right, Calta, I'll give you Calta. Okay. Yeah.
Calta?
Keep going.
Okay, ready? You ready for this?
Yes.
I had Mike Suarez.
Wait, why am I blanking on who Mike Suarez is? Wait, who's Mike Suarez again? What's so funny? What are you laughing at?
You know Mushy Mike?
Oh, Mush.
Yeah.
Mush.
Yeah, Mush.
Oh, yeah.
Dude, first of all, Suarez, I'm telling you right now, he is inches away from slicing necks, okay? I'm telling you right now, you look at him. Take a look at him next time he opens for you. Watch, he's staring at you, waiting for you to, he's going to snap someday. And he's gonna kill
a lot of people. I think he is a quiet storm inside of him, but I'm not.
This is why I know he's a crazy person. At the end of the turkey dinner, we had the turkey carcass, right? Just a little meat on it here and there. I said, hey, jokingly, do you want that? He said, yeah, I'll take it.
Yeah.
He took the carcass and literally, I just heard bones breaking.
Mm-hmm.
He snapped it and cracked it.
Mm-hmm.
And pushed it into a Tupperware container that the carcass shouldn't have fit in, but then it did fit in it.
Yeah.
So that says to me, He's murdered hookers.
It's either that or he knows how to make women. A turkey soup.
It's both. It's both. It can't be both.
But, okay, fine. I Suarez, I'm going to give it to you just because your roster's weak right now.
So I got three. You got one.
No, you have Calta and Suarez. Louis does not count.
Dude, I got Mauricia. I got if he changes into the superhero Puerto Rican, I got three.
No, because here's what happens. Here's why Giannis isn't going to work.
Why?
As Mauricio.
Sure.
You're going to say, Giannis, dress up as Mauricio. We need you. And he's going to go, you know, dude, I don't know if you saw my clips. I do more than just Mauricio. And he's not going to want to do it because he wants you to respect him just as him.
What movie
you're like,
that?
We need you to just please be Mauricio right now.
That's like the Hulk wouldn't get turned into the Hulk in Endgame. It's like, do it. I can't.
Yeah. I want you to just listen to my thoughts as a scientist. Why don't you just turn into the fucking...
Yeah, do the green thing, stupid. I'm dying. Yeah.
Turn into the green thing so we can move some tickets, please. I wonder why I don't have any friends. All right, go ahead.
I got that. All right, and who else? I think that's it. So I know I had Norton.
Oh my God! You gotta be kidding me.
But I had Norton and his girlfriend.
I would rather.
Well, dude, I had Norton and his girlfriend.
Okay. Let me tell you something.
Okay.
I would rather have. I was trying to think of a funny Norton, like another Norton. I can't think of another funny Norton. Like Ed Norton's actually a tough kind of guy. I was gonna say I'd rather have
something Norton.
Yeah. Ed Norton from the Honeymoon. That's not funny.
Yep. You want to work this out on air? I mean, we can take it. We're taking a break in around a half.
We got to kill another 90 minutes.
No, we're good. We don't have to if we keep doing this. Fucking kill the show. Jay's going to come back and beg Dan, please.
I don't know.
Nothing would
can
make
I
me.
Can I ask the criteria? So you're inviting which comics you would want over for Thanksgiving if, like, say, the apocalypse happened and you needed.
Well, no, what we're saying is, if something went down at Thanksgiving, who would you already have at your table? These are the people that Bobby has to his house.
Yeah.
Often.
Right.
Yeah. Thanksgiving dinner. Those are the people I've had at my house for Thanksgiving.
If I assembled a Thanksgiving of my closest comedy friends, I would destroy your Thanksgiving.
You would not. When
it comes to war games?
Maybe if we were writing papers and you were correcting the English.
You're nuts. Right off the bat, Dante. Ugh. Dante Nero, right off the bat.
Listen.
He would take any of these guys apart at the seams.
Listen, first of all, I could have Dante. You would never invite Dante.
Dante's one of my closest friends. I'd have him at my Thanksgiving.
I would
have him at my Thanksgiving.
I've never seen you with Dante, ever. Bring up your Instagram.
Dante and
show me one photo with you and Dante on Instagram.
Dante
one.
And I hang out all the time. Number two, Ari Shaffir.
Ari Shaffir.
You give a spike back to that lunatic, he's going to get something done. Trust me.
He's going to throw pee or blood at you. That's not bad.
Number three and four.
Yeah.
Brian Quinn and Sal Vulcano of the Impractical Jokers.
What are they going to? Are they going to build pranks?
Yeah, I was going to say they'll set up some sort of Home Alone marble trick. They'll do something.
I'll give you those two. But I'm not giving... Dante, you're just throwing that in there.
No, I am telling you,
all right,
Dante.
Good. Me, Jimmy Martinez. Okay,
no,
there you go.
Dante's one of my best friends.
I've never seen you with him. You've never brought up his name. This is bullshit.
It's not. You can call him right now and ask him.
There's no way that your friends...
I promised you if you called Dante right now and said, how close are you with DeRosa? He'd go, DeRosa's one of my best friends. I promise you he would say that.
What if he didn't?
I'm going to find out.
I promise you he will. That's how confident I am that he'll say this.
Dante.
Now.
Now
you threw Louis C.K. into the mix. That's your A-lister.
Hang on. I'm calling him right now.
I'm going to throw an A-lister.
I'm calling him right now. There's no way.
Make sure you let him know, Bob.
No, wait, Dante. We're on the air.
We're on the air right now. Bonfire right now. You have
okay.
1 second. It's going to take a second.
Yeah.
Okay. Is that okay?
Beautiful.
Listen. Are you best friends with Joe DeRosa?
Yeah.
Wait a minute. I'm going to ask you again. Stop. Listen to me. And know that Patrice may be dead, but he can hear. He's still listening. You understand that? Know that. Now, he's still around. Are you and Joe DeRosa best friends?
Yeah.
If there was a Thanksgiving dinner and I invited you or Joe invited you, whose house would you go to?
Joe's.
whose house would you want to go to?
Doesn't matter.
Yours?
I win. Dante, we're talking about if our, either of our Thanksgiving dinners got attacked, who would get through by handing out weapons to their friends? This is all Bobby's roster so far. It's the worst roster I've ever heard.
I didn't know you were going to have Dante. I didn't know you made a connection with Dante because you thought about this years ago. If something bad happened, I need a big friend.
He was my first guy out of the gate. He's my first guy out of the gate.
Joe's my best friend. Okay, yeah, listen. You're not best friends. What's Joe's middle name?
You don't know my middle name.
I don't know. Doesn't matter. What kind of gay guys know their friend's best middle name? This is weird.
Yes, thank you.
You got a valid point there. And I can't say anything back because he'll rip my head off and shit down it. Dante, though. So me and you aren't best friends.
No.
First of all, hang on. Shut up, Joe. Stop directing my friend. Let him answer on his own. What did you say?
No, we're not best friends.
Were we at one point?
I thought so, yeah, but you don't call me motherfucker.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. Hang on one second. Why do you call me motherfucker? I mean, we are friends.
You're asking me a question like you've made an effort to sustain this relationship, and you haven't.
You sound hurt. I'm so sorry.
No, I have a new friend, and you're jealous.
He's single. He's got no family. He's got nothing. Oh my God, Dante. What if Dante beat me up because I was talking shit about him?
I would love it.
Dante.
Yo, I gotta go. I got my agent on the line.
All right. Thank you, Dante.
Dante, I hope you get it, buddy. I'll talk to you. I'll call you tomorrow. Bye.
Love you too, bro.
All right.
I'm taking him away from you.
So my roster.
Watch what I do. I'm taking next Thanksgiving, guess what Dante's gonna be? My house. I'm going to make such an effort to be friends
with
Dante.
It's fine. I don't host a Thanksgiving. I don't give a shit.
Doesn't matter.
Invite him over every Thanksgiving.
He's going to be my best friend next year.
Now,
watch.
Let's keep going here.
I'm getting a bone airing.
Let's keep going here. I have Dante. Okay. I have Ari.
One. I'm not giving you Ari.
Fuck off!
I'm not giving you Ari. Ari, what is Ari going to do? Have you been any? Look, I've been places with Ari, and he gets scared. He's scared of
Ari Shaffir. Get punched repeatedly in the face.
Oh, so you're going to use him as
not flinch.
He got punched in the face and didn't flinch because he can't do anything back. He has to take it. So unless you use an Ari as a barrier to put in front of the door when they come through, then I don't give you Ari. I'm talking about people that actually do something.
You want to say Rosebud? I got Marina.
Oof.
Marina will do some damage.
I mean, this is nuts. All right. Wow. All right. I'm getting this is nuts. All right. Marina, you got two. I'm not giving you Ari. I'll give you half Ari as a barrier only.
Then Ari and Maurice are the same.
Okay, that's fine. Barrier. He's a barrier. He's not a physical threat to anybody. You're not giving him anything.
You throw in an A-lister with Louis.
Yeah. Oh, whoa. Whoa. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I threw an A-lister in.
Yeah. What?
I don't know. Because you know more A-listers than me.
Well, you've got me beat on A-listers.
Okay. Go ahead. Who do you got?
The most recent A-lister that I received a text from.
I don't like your smirk. I don't like it. Look at you.
I'm about to give you a major point here.
Okay, go ahead.
The most recent A-lister to text me and invite me to something was Patton Oswalt. He's not going to do anything in a fight.
No. Oh, my God. I think he actually turns into something when threats are. He just curls up into a ball.
I got to be honest. I really love Patton. I would before I turned him for help, I would throw stuffing at the intruder. Oh.
I guarantee. As soon as the threat knocked on the door, he literally would turn into like a gnome and be on your front lawn. Like, where's Patton? Yeah, that's terrible. Patton Oswalt's terrible.
But.
Yes?
I got a dinner invitation tomorrow night.
Oh, God.
From TJ Miller. Now, I think TJ could do a little damage in a situation.
Good. You know, no, but he would actually kill everybody in the house, too.
TJ's the guy that would turn and kill the kids so they couldn't kill them.
Yeah.
He'd be like, you want to kill? You want to do something?
No, the intruders would come into the house. Where are they? They're all dead. You'll do nothing to anybody. And then he slices his own throat.
I'm going to count that as one. I'm going to put TJ down.
Marina and TJ. Okay, so you got four. I got three.
I got Dante, Marina, TJ. That's two.
I give
That's
you three. Dante, Marina, TJ. Wouldn't you have another one? Didn't you have another one?
You said a half Ari.
Half Ari.
But if you get rid of Maurice, I'll give you Mauricia. Okay. So we've got three on three.
Wait, sure. Wait. You had Q and Sal as well.
Q and Sal. Let's say Q and... That would be five. Four.
That would be five. But
Q and Sal was a funny one. They're not going to fight.
They're cute. Yes.
They're not going to fight.
Yes. Yeah. That's cute. That's like that's like my mush. But Mush is a psycho. Mush would kill people.
So let's just say we have Mush three. Mush will kill people. I'm going to give you full Mauricia.
Full? Hey, papi. Wepa. Wepa.
Yeah. And here's where I'm going to give it to you.
She would just dance for them and then and suck them off?
Here's where I'm going to give it to you. If it's not Mauricia stabbing the intruder, Giannis as himself will talk the intruder to sleep about the banks. Either way, you've got a good defense with Giannis.
That's just, you know what? I don't like that. I don't. All right, I think you win.
No. We got three. We got three.
You have three, and I have three.
Yeah, I'm saying we need now. It's into.
What this about wait? Stop. Something you don't have, and probably won't have.
What?
A loving wife.
What does that have to do with it? Something to live, something to fight for?
Yes, I have motivation and a beautiful young boy.
Let me tell you something. I got 42 video game systems that don't nag me. I'll fucking go out there. I got something to defend. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, they don't wake up with an attitude. Are you coming out and saying goodbye to your son?
No.
Max wants to say goodbye. You want coffee? No, I don't want it if that's the fucking tone you're giving it to me. Are you taking your car or mine? I don't know. Which one do you want me to? Because apparently you have an attitude about one of them. Oh, God.
All right. We got to do tiebreakers now.
Well, I have my wife.
No. Let's keep it in showbiz. This is fun. Showbiz fighters. Okay. But you got it. Here's the rules of the game. You got it. Who conceivably.
I'm still hurt by Dante.
Would you?
That fucking bothers me. That bothers me. You made a secret friend.
It's not a secret friend.
Dude, you have him. You've been friends with him for 6 months. This is a new thing. This is not.
No, it's not. We were already friends, and we became really, really tight during the lockdown.
Why?
I don't know. We just did.
You have nothing in common.
We would call each other and talk about race stuff. We would have these discussions about race. And he was a great guy to talk to about.
I did that about him, but then we got into a fight.
Well, that'll do it.
Because I'm from Boston.
And then you went
That's easy. Easy. This is radio. We have sponsors. This isn't YKWD.
I wasn't going to say.
All right, Jesus.
I'll tell you what I was going to say. It wasn't anything like that. But I did bite my tongue. It wasn't about you and Dante or race. Anyway.
So let me ask you a question, Joe.
Yeah.
Since we're on this topic of friends.
Yes.
Are we friends, still?
Of course.
Are you better friends with Dante than me?
Depends.
Wow, this is nuts. Lou,
no,
this is nuts.
You're one of... Listen.
I mean, God.
Dante and I are... Dante and I are friends in the sense of we started together and we came up together. Yeah. You and I are friends in the sense of you were a guy that took me under your wing, and then eventually I became a pro, and now we're friends. You know what I mean? So it's a little bit of a different dynamic.
Well, no.
I still have a little bit of an older brother thing with you that I see you as.
Yeah, but we've been through the ringer, dude.
Of course.
We've been through
some
stuff.
You're one
of
my best friends in the fucking world.
So we are more close than you and Dante.
I can't. If Dante was built differently, I would maybe answer that question.
What?
He's a big guy.
Okay. What am I?
I'm not scared of you.
Joe, I mean, I'm not.
You could beat me up and I'm still not scared
of you. I could beat the shit out of you.
Of course you could.
Really do talk to me like I can't beat you up, too.
I know you could beat the shit out of me.
He's yelled at me like he's beat me up before. Like in a cab. Remember the time you were yelling at me with Morgan Murphy? And you were screaming
you
at me.
You were yelling at me.
Yeah, but
you yelled at me so bad, Morgan called me and she goes, "Are you okay?"
Yeah, but I can beat you up.
I know you can. Listen, it's not saying much that you could beat anybody could beat me up. By the way, you're right about Ari. Here's why.
What, he's half gay? I mean,
Here's why.
Yeah.
He came down after the... what's it called? After the show on Friday,
sure,
we all went down to my bar, and
legit. You know what? I can't even say it was a crazy guy. He might have just been shit-faced and like a horrible drunk. Because he was clean, very clean, new, like he was well put together. Mm-hmm. But he was just out of his fucking mind. A guy came into the bar.
Did he have shoelaces?
Hell yeah.
No, he was not a homeless person.
No, he had like the vest on with sure. He was put together. But he came in holding a beer from the outside, and like as soon as he walked in, you just felt like uh-oh. Like somebody's here now. Like something just happened. And he was lit the fuck up. And you know, we were kind of like, okay, like let's just keep an eye, make sure that guy doesn't do anything crazy. Bartender went over, she's like, sir, can I get you anything? He's like, no. And he was a little standoffish, and I'm like, just be careful, you know. And then he started getting belligerent with some customers, so I told the bartender, I said, step back, I'll go
belligerent. How, like, was saying what?
Being like, fuck you, man.
That's
like that.
That's aggressive.
So I walked over to him. The bartender goes over and she goes, you got to get something or leave. He goes, fuck you, bitch. So I'm like, all right, now we got a problem, right? So I tell the bartender, I go, just step back, I'll handle this. I went over to him. I go.
He started laughing?
No, I go, buddy, oh. You got to go. You got to go right now.
Really?
He goes, he's screaming, suck my dick at me. What the fuck are you going to do? Try to do some shit. Watch what happens. That kind of shit, right?
Yeah.
So I go, okay. So I walk out the front door. I call the cops.
Sorry.
He's
sorry,
like,
I didn't mean to laugh.
Yeah. He's like in my face in the bar.
Right.
I walk outside. He follows me outside while I call the cops. He's screaming at me outside. Call me a bitch, pussy. He's so drunk, though, that I'm able to just slip past him and I just shut the door and lock it. So now he's locked out and he's like trying to get in and he can't. It's like a Tom and Jerry move, literally. And everybody's like, oh my God, thank God. Like the entire bar was watching. It was crazy. And like and everybody's like, thank God you're all right. Thank God you're all right. You know where Ari was? He couldn't have been farther back.
Yes.
Into the bar. And then and then all my friends that we were with him, they go, you know, if he did anything, we all would have jumped in. I'm like, yeah, I'm fucking sure you would have.
Yeah. They, no, 100%.
Not one person walked. So you're right about Ari.
If I was there, what would I have done?
I don't know.
I'll tell you.
It was crazy.
I'll tell you what I would have done.
I know what I hope you would have done.
And when he said, suck my dick, I would have blown him right there. And right when he came, I'd walk him outside and be like, come on, buddy, you got to go.
Well, I bet he had a big one on him.
You think so?
Yeah. He had big dick energy. But I mean, this guy was like, it was wild, dude.
Yeah.
It was wild. And you can't. Yeah,
that neighborhood is, I'm sorry to say, Joe, that neighborhood's creepy.
No, it's not. It's the Lower East Side.
Oh, that's the... I mean, yes, dude. I mean, am I crazy? It's creepy.
The creepiest neighborhood in Manhattan now is this neighborhood. Because all the... you ever been in this neighborhood at 9 o'clock when the fucking sun goes down, dude? It's fucking creepy, dude.
The East Village is creepy.
East Village and Lower East Side are two different neighborhoods.
Are you... You're in Alphabet City.
No, Lower
no,
East Side.
I'm Lower East Side.
Which is a sketchy part of town.
It's a sketchy part of town.
It's
I remember we were there. It's crazy. It's a crazy part of town.
It's not though,
dude. I remember being there that night. The people were walking around. My spidey senses are off.
It's
the whole
no
time.
More. It's no more sketchy. It's no more sketchy than the West Village is at night.
I mean, I guess, but it's sketchy.
Yeah, I don't think it is either. I think like the West Village, East Village, Alphabet City, Lower East Side, Soho are all.
I have
like
seen.
This, there's a lot of people and a lot of weirdos around.
I'm not just saying this because my bar is in one place, and I'm talking about some. I am not just saying this. I have seen way, way, way more crazy shit happen at that McDonald's that's now closed near the Comedy Cellar.
That's actually the Comedy Cellar now.
Yeah, I heard.
Oh, what was that?
But, no, I heard.
I'll get you in. You want me to get you in?
I heard.
I'll get you a spot.
Yeah, but I didn't mean it like I heard. I just meant like, I heard. But it's that area. You will find more. There is a Michelin star restaurant a block from my bar. You will not find that in the West Village in that area. You won't. You won't even find craft cocktail bars in that. You've got to walk away.
Look, I don't know. This is the gayest conversation I've ever had. I don't know what a craft cocktail bar is.
I don't think you know what you're saying.
I just know from being in your neighborhood and being in the West Village, yes, there's more crazy people now than there was in the West Village because of that no bail. But, dude, back then, since I've been in New York, the East Village has been crazier. Thompson Square Park is
East Village,
nuts.
But that's the East Village. I'm on the Lower East Side.
What the fuck is the difference?
You cross Houston. They're two different neighborhoods.
Yeah.
It's like saying the Upper East Side is Chelsea or you know what I mean? Or is Gramercy. It's not. Right. It's two different neighborhoods.
But even that part is nuts. Isn't that where the comedy club used to be? The other comedy club?
Which one?
Remember the Eastville? Was it East? What was the comedy
East
club?
No, Eastville
over
is
there?
In the East Village.
What was the comedy
it's
club?
It's now New York Comedy Club. What was Fourth the Street.
Laugh Lounge.
Laugh Lounge. Wasn't that where he is
that
places?
Was Lower East Side, yeah. So from what I hear.
Sort of.
But that's where all the rock clubs were, right?
Yeah, but dude, you're judging the Lower East Side by a decade ago. And I'm saying...
Maybe I am.
It's not...
I live in Westchester, which is a very nice neighborhood.
I will tell you this. Lower East Side, you'll find more, as you put it, foofy stuff than you will in... My point is this. People talk about certain neighborhoods in New York. They'll say this stuff about neighborhoods in Brooklyn. They'll say it about the Lower East Side. They'll say it about parts of when you get up north toward Harlem and stuff. They'll go, oh, that neighborhood's rough. That's a rough neighborhood. It's like, no, it's actually not a rough neighborhood. It's got a little more grime to it, meaning there's more graffiti and stuff like that. But these neighborhoods that are supposedly the good neighborhoods that are pricier, they have way more crazy shit happening in them.
I can't fight you on this because I haven't lived in the city in 10 years.
Right. Yes.
So I can't, I'm fighting you on something that I used to know because I lived in Hell's Kitchen for... Right.
We're not fighting.
50, well, not fighting, but, you know, debating.
Actually, where you used to live
We're going to fight if you keep pointing that thing at me.
Where you used to live in Manhattan is a perfect example of what talking about.
Where we used to live.
Yes.
Yes.
Hell's perfect Kitchen. Example. Remember how people used to talk about Hell's Kitchen when we lived there? They'd be like, oh, that's a fucking rough neighborhood. It's like, what are you talking about? No, it's not.
It was.
They all were at one point, right?
And then the gays moved in and made it awesome.
What do you think's happened on the Lower East Side?
Are all the gays down the Lower East Side?
It's all fucking mustache barber shops.
Oh, my God. Yeah. I'm going to come out of your sandwich shop more.
Yeah, I'll give you a fucking 8-inch. Oh, God, what a bad joke. But no, craft cocktail bar means bars where they make, you know, like those like speakeasy-style cocktail bars where they put muddled fruit into a drink.
I know nothing about that. Nothing about that. I don't know. That sounds foofy. That's foofy.
It is foofy.
You like foofy.
I don't. I don't like craft cocktail bars, but I'm telling you, there's a lot of those on the Lower East Side.
All right. Well, listen, we have to take a break.
All right. That's fair.
We're going to take a nice break, but I got something. We're not going to fight, but I have something else that we're going to talk about.
We never finished our game.
We'll finish our game when we come back, but also.
And this?
Yes.
Please.
Yes. I'm not going to tell you, but yes, because me and you have had this debate for a long time.
Yeah.
And now it's coming to the light again. And maybe we'll solve it on air with the fans and everybody in the room. Christine's here. Lou is here. Black Lou's here. Yeah. Jacobs is in Florida, but he's here. Mm-hmm. And Big J is here in our hearts. And Dan Soto's in the sky with us. And yes. We got Joe DeRosa. I thought a closer friend than we are, but we got Joe DeRosa.
Very close.
Joe DeRosa, he's got shows this Thursday, March 30th, in Hamtramck, Michigan, then Grand Rapids, Chicago, Bativa, Illinois, through April 2nd. You can go to JoeDeRosaComedy.com.
No. Joe DeRosa Info.
JoeDeRosaInfo.com. And I actually did that run. Really fun run.
Yeah.
Fun rooms. Yeah. You're going to have a blast on that thing. So make sure you check him out. And of course, Big J. Oakeson has his brand new special, Dog Belly, April 5th. It's on youtube.com/@BigJOakeson. So make sure you check that out. We'll be right back with the Bonfire.
And now back to the Bonfire with Big J. Oakeson and Robert Kelly.
I'm at a payphone trying to call home. All of my change I spent on you. Where have the times gone, baby? It's all wrong. Where are the plans we made for two? Yeah, I know it's hard to remember the people we used to be. It's even harder to picture.
three, four, left, right, left, right, left, right. Body blow, body blow. Kick, kick. Yeah.
You turn your back on tomorrow, 'cause you forgot yesterday.
We're back. It's the bonfire, everybody. It's okay. Jay's not here, but it's okay. Lou's holding up the sign right now. It's a billboard. It's Faction Talk 103, Sirius XM. This show is boomer-proof, baby. We've made it boomer-proof. Black Lou made the Reeds 45-point Helvetica and a double-spaced. Everything's bigger in here. Everything's bigger and better, except for my belly. I'm very excited to be back. A lot of Bonfire fans this weekend up in Saratoga. Crackle, crackle at the end of the show, which is really nice to hear. Great fans. Thanks for coming out. Make sure you check out Big J's special. It's coming out the 5th, April 5th. YouTube.com/@BigJOkerson. It is unbelievable. Produced by Ari Shafir, one of Joe's best friends. He's not your best friend.
One of my best friends.
Of course, Joey D is in the house. Joe DeRosa, he's not best friends. Christine's here. Lou is here. Black Lou's here. Jacob is in Florida, but he's here. I'm dying to know what knife camp is. Wow, I want to go.
You sit in a house, you make knives.
That's not camp. I want to go. This is like a place.
It wasn't really camp. I was just kidding when I said that.
No, okay. I thought there was a knife camp.
I believe you, because there is a guy who does knife camp in Pennsylvania, Bobby. You'll love.
There's a guy.
2-day course.
Yeah, there's a guy in Brooklyn that does it. We should take that course and make knives. Yeah, let's do that. I'll take
it with you.
I'm so mad at my wife.
Why?
We're going to get into this other stuff. Joe DeRosa is in the house. Joey D, best friends with Dante Nero. Didn't know that.
We
got this thing. I just want to talk about this real quick about my wife. I want to throw this out there to you.
You're probably wrong, but yes.
You're such a girl.
I'm not a girl. Stop being so much of a guy. How about that?
That's a girl thing would say. That's
how about let go of what happened 25 years ago
and 25.
Become an emotional person?
I am emotional.
All the wrong emotions.
That is not true. I'm more emotional than you.
Bullshit.
Listen.
Once a day.
Dude, of course you do. You have a mirror. I was last night, Max. Okay. We have Rob Dukes.
Is this what you're mad about?
No. I'm mad about Dawn because we're flying to Aruba. I have Global One. Flying is big to me. I need Global One. I need Clear. I need it all. I need everything that can make the anxiety go away. I don't want to touch people. I don't want to look at people. I don't want to talk. I don't have to worry about luggage. I want to get on the plane as quick as I can. I want to sit down. I don't have to fly first class everywhere, but I need it to be as flawless as possible. And she kind of helps me out with that. So we have Global One. So when we go to Aruba once a year, I go out of the country. I don't have to wait in that holy shit crappy fucking line to get back into the United States in Aruba, which is sometimes astronomical.
Sure.
But we don't. Because I got us all Global One. We fly through the line. She didn't renew it. She let it go. Yeah. She let it go. And then she tells me, oh, we gotta do it. And I'm like, well, do it. Why would you ever let it? It's an easy fix. So she finally does it. But now, because of COVID, because of all the bullshit, there's a 9-month delay.
Yeah.
Her and Max went through, but mine's still not through. So I don't have Global One. So on the way back from Aruba, those two are going to fly through thing.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, we'll wait with you. If you wait with me, I'll be so angry at you while waiting in that line. We might not make it through the line. You need to go through with Max because I can't have you near me. And so now I'm like, well, just put my Global One in. Did you call anybody? No. Because she doesn't travel, so she doesn't care about.
I feel like the man that sits at the head of the table should handle this.
You know what? Jacob, I don't need that. I don't need you. I'm not good. You know what? No knife camp for you. How's that? No.
I was with you until you said, I was with you, and then I was fine when Dawn said, Look, I made a mistake, but we'll wait with you. I think that was huge. I think that's as much of a gesture as you can give after making a slip like that.
Okay, great.
And I get being annoyed at the slip, so I'm on your side there, but I also think that her penance or her apology, whatever you want to call it, for the slip is also pretty fucking good.
Okay, so you're saying...
And there's nothing that can be done about it to fix it.
You, Joe DeRosa.
Yes.
You, Joe DeRosa. Your wife
yes.
kind of fucked you out of this thing, right? Mm-hmm. And now you're in line. It's like an hour and a half line you're waiting in, mm-hmm. right? And she's there with you, with mm-hmm. a nine-year-old or a nine-and-a-half-year-old. And you're waiting in line with them, and you're there because of the person you're in line... Wait a minute. The person you're there is right there with you. You would rather have them there with you or just you guys go through... And let me do this by myself so I don't get angry.
You shouldn't be getting angry at that point, is my point.
Yeah.
But that's not what I said. What I said is the gesture of immediately saying selflessly, I won't take advantage of it and I will wait with you, is a huge apology. And then you just say, it's okay, babe. I appreciate that. Go through. And
this is why you don't sit at the head of the table, because you should be on my side no matter what.
Yeah, yeah. So stand there getting angry either way, because you're going to be angry either way.
I'd rather be angry by myself.
I'm not saying I understand. I'm not saying don't let them go through. Let them go through.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying her selflessly saying, I will stand there now on the line with you is a huge, dude, that's huge. That's huge. People don't do that. You got to understand that.
What is huge about it?
Brother, I am out there. All right. I'm telling you something. I am out there.
Yeah, with your best friend, Dante.
Yeah. No, seriously, listen to me here. This is good advice. I am out there in a way that you're not in dealing with people on more intimate levels more frequently than you are. Because when you're a bachelor, that's just how it works. I am telling you something. Somebody that recognizes something and goes, shit, I fucked up. It's annoying. I'm sorry. And they do everything they can as a gesture to show you they recognize the mistake. That is as good as you can get in a human being.
Hang on.
That's amazing.
It wouldn't even have... But here's the thing you are missing, Joseph.
What's that?
Is that she didn't do it and never told me... Wait.
Yeah.
And now I brought it up like, hey, did you ever...
I understand.
No. So I...
That sucks.
She could have prevented it.
That sucks.
And
But there's no fixing it. How long are you going to be mad at that?
She didn't try to fix it until I brought it up today, the day before. And she was like, oh, yeah. So it's like she had...
Okay. I didn't realize it was all today.
She had 8 months to try to maybe do something. Maybe I could call somebody. Maybe I could say, hey, does anybody who follow me work in the customs? Maybe, hey, dude, we'll fix it. We can speed it up. You know what I mean?
You're right. Fuck her.
Yeah, fuck her. Thank you very much. You're back at the head of the table. Two men.
I missed that part. I didn't realize, first of all, that you only got this news today, so you haven't had time to cool off. I thought you were saying it's been like weeks of this.
No.
And I didn't realize that also she said I didn't renew it 9 months ago and then just didn't do anything.
I want to tell
that,
you
that I get being a little.
Wait, she did renew it. It's just yours happened to not go through
because
like you're just delayed.
They're so backed up, right? But so it could go in a week. It could be a year. But here's the thing: if she renewed it, just renewed it without it lapsing, they give you a 24-month what's that?
Grace period.
Grace period. Thank you. I knew you'd know the word grace. Grace period to you can still go through. We're going to let you through no matter what. Because it lapsed, she let it lapse.
She let it lapse for 24 months?
We had to start over again. Then she started over again. And then today she's like, yeah, we can. And I'm like, well, did you try? She's like, I did, but nothing. I'm like, what?
All right, so she did try to fix it. You just need a couple days to let it pass. That's all.
Well, no. Let's say it was going to happen. It's all going to go away. It's gone. I let it go. I didn't.
No, not fully yet. Come on. I know you. I know you. Come on.
But it's going to come back. This is the thing.
That's the trick. Don't let it come back. Don't ruin your vacation at the end by letting it come back. Come to terms with it.
Okay.
Meditate
on
it.
I'm going to
let go
of it. I'm going to call you.
Yes.
When we're headed to the airport, on the whatever day it is, the 7th, when we're coming back, I'm going to call you while I'm in line. And you talk to me while I'm in line.
I'm not fucking talking to you for an hour and a half.
I do feel like sending them through and you just throwing on headphones and doing it on your own is the right way.
Yeah, I agree with you.
I think that's the right way to do it. Yeah, because I've just been subject to...
abuse?
To anger. To male anger.
you know what I'm talking about.
And I, you know, that's a situation where I'm like, yeah, they probably want to just go. And I, it's so funny as you say that, I'm like, oh, Jay's been asking me to set up Global One for him for like 5 years, if not longer, and I still haven't done it.
Oh, my God. And you got to go down. You know you have to go to JFK and get fingerprinted.
Yeah, well, we had to do it for TSA PreCheck. What I tell him, though, is I go, I'm like, I can't do it for you. It's something that you actually have to go and do yourself.
You have to, but
and
you
what
have,
does
you
he
have
say to that?
He knows.
Okay, so he knows.
Yeah, he knows.
But you have to go with him?
He's not like
you have to go with him.
Yeah, I have to. I'd you like both, to get it done too. He's not like mad at me about it. I just when he brought it up, I was like,
okay,
oh, shit.
That's fair.
If you don't have Global One and he has it, that's more infuriating.
No. We both. I want it.
Yeah. What's up?
Just for Canada.
Yes. But who's is this? Is
what? Why are you going to be a contrarian?
Being a contrarian.
Well, I mean, I'm sure you don't do this with Dante.
Is this a, no, I do. I do. I yell at Dante. Dante and I yell at each other. Is this a household thing where it's like, Dawn, that was your department. You said you'd handle that and you didn't?
Yes.
Or is this a, why didn't you do this for me? Because out of osmosis, you should have just understood.
Household
okay.
thing.
Okay. All right. Thing. Okay. Then that's fair.
So
that's
fair. I want your help on this, too. I want to just tell you this. A little therapy with me right now. Because this is a, you see, I'm so happy, but I did have something happen last night that kind of.
And I have a criticism about your happiness, but go ahead.
Who says that?
I do.
I mean, what?
I do.
I mean, who fucking says I have a criticism about? I mean, Lou, I'm going to look at you because I can't look that way right now. Who says I have a criticism of your happiness?
Not me. You're the happiest guy I've ever worked with, Bob.
Oh,
well, give it 3 months. No, go ahead. And then I'll tell you the
all
thing.
Right, so last night, I have Rob Dukes coming over and his drummer from Generation Kill. And great band, look him up. And I got my square friend, I have a man friend, Big Shoulders Joe. You've met him. Big Shoulders Joe.
Do you call him that because I'm no shoulders, Joe?
I call him that because he has shoulders, unlike you.
Okay.
So, yeah.
But I mean, is it related to... Okay.
There's nothing to do with that. He's just a big shoulders.
Okay.
And they all... And like, so the guy... Max is drumming. He's taking drumming lessons. He's actually in drumming... Just got out of drumming lessons. And he does double pedals. He's playing metal.
Wow, it's great.
He's trying to, you know... This guy is a metal band. Double pedals. He comes over. Max, who is outgoing, who... I mean, we'll walk up to anybody. We took him to the opening. He had a little thing at ShopRite open. He bought Girl Scout cookies, and then he passed them out to everybody. In the crowd, he's like, you want a Girl Scout cookie? I mean, it was crazy. He's that guy. He's that type of kid. He goes into his room and hides. And I'm like, hey, where's Max? Max. He's like, I don't want to. And I'm like, Max, what's wrong? Like, he's like, nothing. I just, you know. And Dawn's like, I think he's nervous. You know, I think. And I'm like, yeah, but he's the drummer. You can help him. He wanted to. So they're like, yeah, don't worry about it. So I leave. But I think as his father, I should try to help him through this fear. I should be like, hey, man, I'm not going to force you to do anything. But let's try to get out of this. Let's, come on, but what's wrong? Blah, blah. Won't. So then Joe comes. And I'm like, Joe's here. And I bought him this little, it's called the Hummingbird speaker. It's a little tiny speaker that you put on anything and it makes it into a big speaker. Shower door, a box, whatever. I go, show him. Come out and show him the speaker. He doesn't want to do it. It's weird. It's uncanny. I think something's wrong. So then I go into the room. We're about to leave to go to the cigar bar and smoke. And I go, Max, I go, what's going on, buddy? What's happening? Talk to me. And he's like, no, nothing. Nothing. And I'm like, I used to do that when I was a kid. You know, I remember doing that in juvie jail. What's wrong? I'd be crying. What's wrong? Nothing. Because I couldn't. I was like, Max, please tell me.
Right.
You talk to me. He's like, nothing. I go, you can tell me anything. Say whatever you want. I want to know. Tell me how you're feeling. He goes, anything? Remember you said that. You said anything.
Right.
And I go, anything. He goes, all right. Well, you're being kind of a manipulated motherfucking jackass right now, Dad.
Wow.
I meant your feelings.
That is his feelings.
No. I don't, not, no.
The child, he doesn't know how to say it the
dude,
right way.
I was like, you're lucky I don't slap your face right now. I was like, I go, give me your phone. You don't talk to your father that way. You don't talk to any adult that way. And
right.
I'm like, and I was, I had to leave. I was so sad.
Right.
I left.
Right.
I just left. I was like, go, darn. Right. He just called me a manipulative motherfucking jackass.
Right.
And half of me, it took a lot not to crack up a little bit because it right. did make me laugh. Because mm-hmm. I don't, where the fuck did he learn manipulative? Right. You know what I mean? Yeah. And I was being, I was. He had the correct, I was definitely
and
trying
he
to.
He called you on it.
And he called me on it, but right. you don't call me that. And I was bullshit.
Right.
And I left. I took off. I took his phone. I was like, you're not getting this. The point being is this. I meant he misunderstood what I was saying. He thought, tell me, you can say what you want to me.
Yeah.
I meant, I'm feeling sad. I'm feeling mm-hmm. shy. I wanted to know what your feelings were.
Yeah.
Not how you felt about me, you little cocksucker.
Right. So he didn't do anything wrong. He just didn't understand the directive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But.
So what. You?
My point is this. Yeah. Is like. What the fuck? Could you imagine calling at 9:30 saying to your dad, like,
yeah,
I should have hit him.
I'm kidding. Dude, I didn't use those terms with my parents at that age, but I said things that were equally as offensive or hurtful. He's a kid, dude. My opinion is this. He's got his feelings like anybody else. He might be having social anxiety. And there's nothing worse than when you're trying to tell somebody, leave me the fuck alone right now. Yeah. And you're going, come on, dude. Come on, dude. Come on.
No.
You know what I mean?
I wasn't doing that.
But you know what I'm saying.
I know, but you're making me sound like an asshole.
I'm not making you sound like an asshole.
I was very gentle. I was very, hey, man.
I know. I'm saying what it translates into.
Right. Okay.
And I get it. You're trying to be a dad and try to understand. Right. And I can imagine you're upset because your kid's being in a way that you haven't seen him be. Mm. But then, like, you put yourself in my head. You put yourself in his shoes. He's having, like, panic and shit.
But that's what scared me. Is like,
I know,
came out of the fucking blue.
But maybe he just needs time to get it, like, you know what I mean? Mm. I got to figure out how to deal with this.
I gave him a 5-milligram gummy. It felt better.
I don't know. Were you asking my advice?
I was.
My advice is you say, buddy, when you're ready to talk about this, you talk to me about it.
Well, the next day I woke up and I went out and I shut the TV. I go, listen, buddy, you can't ever, ever use that language with me, your mother, or adults. You just can't right now. It's just unacceptable. I go, but you can tell me whatever you want. And if I am being manipulative, you can use that word and talk to me about it. I will work with you with anything, but you can't call me a fucking motherfucker, jackass, manipulator. You can't. You can't. Right. Even, but now that we're talking about it, it's kind of cool.
He put some spice on it, really.
I'm kind of proud of him in a weird way that he was like, you're being a manipulative, jackass motherfucker, so fuck off. Listen, I want to get into this with you because, dude, it's flying. I could talk. I mean, dude, we just picked it back up.
Yeah.
Fuck it. I mean, it's like back in the day in my living room.
I know. We got a good energy.
We do have a good energy. Listen.
So happy Jonathan Majors is going down.
This is what I want to talk to you about. Yeah. First of all, Jonathan Majors, who is...
I'm not happy he did these horrible things, and I'm not happy
allegedly.
That a guy is... Allegedly.
Allegedly.
But I am happy that Marvel... I'm just happy that all of... The weaknesses are now... Marvel is starting to slowly topple, finally.
Okay, first of all, this actor, Jonathan Majors, is one of my favorite new actors. And he yesterday, or the day before, was over the weekend in New York City, in Chelsea, was allegedly strangled his girlfriend, who is white, that Lou, Black Lou, told me about. And because if it was a black girl, she would have hit him back. A white girl went home for the night, next day filed charges.
Mm-hmm.
But allegedly filed charges. They came and arrested him. And he is the new Thanos, the main villain of the.
No, he's not Thanos.
No,
he represents
the new.
Oh, OK.
The what Thanos was to the first.
He's Kang.
Kang.
Yeah.
Of the second chapter, whatever they call it.
And his version of Kang stunk anyway. So
well, here's the problem with you.
Even Keith said it. And he's the biggest Marvel fan on Earth.
I love this guy, and you don't... Well, Ant-Man's the wrong vehicle. They should have gave him something else.
No. What they should have done was make Kang look like Kang in the comics. Instead of it just being a dude with a blue suit on. Like, it just wasn't cool. It was like they fucked up MODOK. They fucked up. They had these chances to do these really cool things, and they're really dropping the ball. But I love, and it's funny to me that it took everybody 17 fucking movies to figure it out. That everybody is finally going, it's too many jokes. Oh, really, you dumb fucks? Is it too many jokes? Is it too many jokes? You're just now realizing this, that Thor, Love and Thunder is written like a fucking Leslie Nielsen movie. It took you four fucking
all,
Thor movies to figure this shit
first
out.
First of all, I like
fucking morons.
I liked funny Thor. The first Thor sucked when he was so stoic and fucking
first Thor
Viking.
Was awesome.
Oh, it was sucked. His stupid blonde eyebrows sucked.
His stupid blonde
eyebrows. Yeah, they
eyebrows.
Dyed his eyebrows. He looked ridiculous. Thor in Love and Thunder was amazing. He was funny and witty and had some personality. It was great.
I feel bad that I said I'm so happy Jonathan Majors. It's not a thing to celebrate, but
allegedly. And first of all, his people say it's all bullshit. This is all bullshit.
What else are they going to say?
I believe his people.
I'm not saying he did it, but what else are your people going to say?
I don't think he did it. And first of all, you know, a girl goes to grab your phone. I mean,
no, she looked at his phone.
This is why I love my wife.
She didn't grab his phone. She looked at it.
This is why I love my wife.
Yeah.
When I said that this guy, who she likes too, he's been in a couple movies we like.
He's a good actor.
Jonathan Majors, I go, yeah, he choked his wife. My wife went, what did she do?
Oh, Jesus Christ. Yeah, she didn't renew global entry. Yeah, there you go. Wait, but why is... get to the thing in this that I need to know about, that I've not looked at my phone.
Okay, well, your little... Here's it, you're so celebrating Marvel's demise, which hasn't happened yet, and I don't think it will.
It's just starting to topple.
It's starting, but it's not going to. Okay, it's not going to. Because Marvel has better everything. Okay.
Shut up, dude.
Oh, you're a DC guy.
Even Mike Lawrence, who's the biggest Marvel fan on planet Earth, he goes, look, I still love the Marvel movies. He goes, I loved the new Ant-Man. He goes, but I have to admit, they're comic books at this point. If you're not watching all of it, you don't know what's going on anymore.
Okay, that's fine, but
does not make for a good movie. I'm sorry.
Well, your Flash.
Yes.
Your Flash movie.
Yeah. Why may it be derailed? What does that mean?
Well, because, Marvel, Jonathan Majors, may have had a little assaulting that is allegedly your Ezra Miller.
This is old news, Bob. This is over a year old, this story.
Yeah, but...
It's not getting derailed. Oh, so you dug up an old story in the hopes that it would be relevant to Jonathan Majors. The Flash is so good, they're putting the movie out. This kid is like kidnapping people. They don't care. They wrote a storyline to send him back into another dimension at the end of the movie so they can still put this fucking movie out. Oh, thank God. Dude, I thought something else happened.
No, this movie's not coming out.
Yes, it is.
Did you hear what he just did?
He didn't do anything, or else Lou would have that story.
Lou, pull up the news story about Ezra. You didn't hear about it? It happened Friday night.
Go ahead. What's the news story?
He decapitated a child.
No, he didn't.
And then he fucked it. He banged it in an alley. That's what he did. That's why it's not going anywhere.
Okay.
This movie's over, buddy.
Look how good looking he is.
He is so... Listen, man.
Look at that. I would smooch his little pecker.
Yeah. It's her. It's a her.
Or is they.
They.
I would smooch their little pecker.
I love that. That video where he got arrested, you were talking about, where he's back in the car and he turns trans just to get protected. It's like a superhero.
He's cool about it at first. He's like, cool. He's talking to the cops. He's like, you guys are cool, like, whatever. And then he's like, he even says, just so you know, I prefer they, please. And then the cop, like, Demonslayer makes the mistake and just goes, sir. And he just goes, it is a hate crime. It's like, whoa, dude. This kid just switched lanes on him.
He switched
lanes.
And
the guy's not being a dick. He's just like, he made a mistake. You know?
Yeah. He was like, listen, dude. Remember Patrice down the cellar when he was fighting that trans girl from next door, the singer?
No, what happened?
He was out going toe to toe. And he kept going, listen, fella, dude, hang on, sir. Let me, okay, captain. And then finally she goes, he goes, your teeth so fucked up, it looks like your tongue's in jail, bitch. Fucking. And then walked away. We were on a fucking... Patrice just gave up. He was like, oh, shit, I'm out.
Was he laughing?
No, dude, the place blew up with that line. I mean, fucking great. Good. I mean, he is a pretty...
They.
They.
Yes. I'm not saying that to be smart, Ed. Like, I do respect the process. Yeah. I'm sorry evolving.
I didn't say anything.
You said it without saying it.
I didn't say anything. I just took a deep breath. I respect
pronouns.
I respect that you respect pronouns because you have to respect pronouns.
Yeah.
Because of the people you go out with.
What?
You like they, thems.
Yeah, there's such a funny thing in the David Spade book where the book, I mean, God's been out for 5 years at this point, but his audiobook, Polaroid Guy in a Snapchat World, where he talks about all the actresses like Courtney Cox being like, Caitlyn Jenner is so beautiful. She's so gorgeous. Oh my God, I love it. He goes, and then the reporter will be like, yeah, you kind of remind me of her. And they're like, hey, fuck you, dude.
Yeah.
Like, how fast they fucking turn.
Oh, dude, there was a video on my Instagram of these two Spanish girls, quote unquote. Mm. And then they were like, hey, daddy, what's going on? And then they just went into the voice. Yo, papi. And they just went back into their regular voices. It was nuts. What about that girl? Remember the...
Bailey J? I think about her every day.
Stop. No. It's not going
to
happen.
I haven't talked to Bailey in a long time.
I was
I
down...
Bailey.
Her husband came to my show in Tampa.
They're wonderful people.
It's so funny. The first day when I told Joe that I was in touch with Bailey J, I got in touch with her husband and said, will you please come do my podcast? Again, another first in podcasting. I was the first one to have transgendered people on my show.
Yes.
Yes. And I called, oh, Jesus Christ. My God.
Oh, my God. I would suck
Jesus Christ. Hang
dick.
On. All right. Hang on. Stop.
I've gone on record many times. I would. I still would.
Christine just brought up a plethora of naked Bailey J's with her wonderful Italian penis.
God, she's perfect.
All right, listen.
55? What is that? Oh, it's saying number of pictures. I was like, well, she's not 55.
God. Okay, listen. So I
oh,
tell.
Sorry, I'm getting a little short of breath here.
I called Joe. I go, dude, I have Bailey J coming to my house for a podcast, for dinner, and then a podcast. My wife passive aggressively made sausage soup. She's hilarious.
By the way, I told you, you'd asked me to do the show that night, and I go, I'm not available. And then you told me Bailey was on, and I made myself available.
Not only did he make himself available, he came dressed up.
I was so excited.
He showed up with dress shoes. He was clicking. I heard him clicking coming down the hallway. He had dress shoes. Did you have a vest or something on? He had jeans.
No, it wasn't that. But yeah, I tried to present my best.
The best. And then he shows up and he's sitting there nervous. And then Bailey J's husband was there too. And I remember Joe's face. He's like, oh, that's great. Yeah. Who's he? And I went, that's Bailey J's husband. He went, come on. What the really? Really?
Really upset. I was really upset.
What did you think? You were going to come over and hook up?
Yeah.
You have no problem with that.
With what?
Would you date a trans woman?
I don't know. I've never been presented with the opportunity. I mean, potentially.
Presented is a great word.
I'm not closed off to the idea.
Really?
I don't know, though. You know?
Great. That's great.
But I'm telling you right now, without a question in my mind, I would, if Bailey J was here right now and said, Joe, let's go get a hotel and have a good time, I would do it in 2 seconds.
2 seconds.
I wouldn't bat a fucking eye at it. At the idea.
If you were to be with Bailey J, if she was like, let's go to my hotel and have sweet love all night,
I would be excited.
And anything she wanted to do.
And I even, honestly, and I'm not trying to sound like, oh, I'm Mr. Progressive. I hate even saying it like this because it makes it sound like I'm making a novelty out of the concept. I'm not. I'm saying I know that much about myself.
Right.
That at least with Bailey, who I've met and whatever, like, I'm like, I'd be very excited about that proposition in the same way I would about a cisgendered woman that I was attracted to.
A regular girl.
Presenting it to
that's
to
a regular girl, right?
Stop.
So, I'm just asking.
I'm not doing that
I don't
you.
Know what that means.
I'm not doing that
like,
with you.
Is Christine a cis? What is it?
I am cisgender.
But you're a girl.
Born with a vagina.
But you're
yes.
you're just a girl.
Yeah.
Just a girl who met a guy who had a podcast.
Born with a
and a special coming out April 5th.
Whereas you are a trans woman.
So you would kiss, make out, Soft kiss.
In 2 seconds flat. I'm super attracted to Bailey. I always have been. I've made this very clear publicly for years. By the way, I was saying this, and not to pat myself on the back, but I was saying this shit on Opie and Anthony.
Well, it's not hard. You're
when there was
next
a
to...
lot more pushback, and it was a lot scarier to be a guy going out into the world saying, you know.
What are you talking about? The third mic did it every night.
Oh, that is true.
Yeah, what are you talking about? The third mic.
Yeah.
You're in good company.
Norton, thanks. Norton really opened the zipper for all of us.
Yeah, that was the safest place in the world to talk about that. Are you crazy?
That's a good point. I forgot about that. Yeah, Norton and I remember.
Yeah, Bailey.
My favorite thing Norton ever said. We were talking about Buck Angel and Bailey.
You got in trouble with Buck Angel.
Buck Angel did message me.
She was gonna.
And in fairness, I was being disrespectful. I apologize.
What did
Buck.
You say about it? I forget.
I just was making jokes about how like. I was just being funny about like Buck could beat the shit out of me. You know what I mean?
And she did threaten you.
She didn't threaten me. She just was like, yeah, dude, you sound like an ass. Why don't you watch your mouth?
Well, it's a threat.
Or he, I guess he would say, he, sorry, he. Buck.
Oh, I can't.
But I said to Jim, would you rather eat Buck Angel's pussy or suck Bailey J's dick? And Jim said, it's a tough call between those two delicious choices. Which is such a funny response, and it's perfect. Norton, whoever thought we'd see the day where Jim Norton was the most progressive of all of us?
Yeah.
He was out there first.
Way ahead of the game.
Yeah.
Way ahead of the game. And now he's happy.
Jacob saw Buck Angel.
I just saw a video with Buck. I got to re-look it up.
I can't look at it.
Buck did a scene with somebody I know. I can't remember who it is.
I'm not. Not because I don't care about it. I just. It's just. It's not my type of vagina. Let's put it
that
way.
Right.
It's just, you know, if that was on a woman, I wouldn't like that type of vagina.
Buck.
What do I mean? What is the one down? I can't even look at it.
That's a born vagina. That's the vagina.
I know. I understand
I watched a documentary about him, and it was tremendous.
Yeah, what was it called?
I think it's called
Buck the Fuck.
I think it's just called Buck or something. I don't remember, but really? it was
suck my buck.
He's awesome.
I got nothing.
I actually felt bad that I made like any jokes and stuff.
All right,
I'm serious.
Christ. Okay, that's good. That's nice that you feel that way.
You said to me the other day when we were talking on the phone about comedy and like.
God,
you know,
what are you bringing up fucking secret shit for?
Because.
I mean, what the
you
hell?
You just told me about you yelling at your son, and your son calling you a motherfucker.
Hang on. No.
This is too secret now?
This is the problem with you.
What?
You add fucking spice to shit. I didn't yell at Max ever. I didn't even yell at Dawn.
No, I'm saying.
I didn't yell at anybody. I'm yelling at you right now because you're fucking saying I yelled. I didn't yell at anybody.
I'm saying.
Take the yell back.
I love when I take it back. I like when you get peshy voice like that.
I get it. I don't get that with Jay. Me and Jay having a good time.
Yeah. You don't get it with Jay because you don't get a chance to talk.
Jesus Christ. I mean, full circle. Jesus Christ. This is bullshit.
You don't get it with Jay after he explains a South Park episode to you for 27 minutes? Joey, I know you're not a fan of the show, but let me break it down beat by beat. All right, great. I guess I got nowhere to go.
The guy has a nice time before the show. One time he was telling me a story, and one eye was looking at Christine, the other I was looking at Lou. I was like, what's going on? Are you all right?
But no, you and I were talking the other day, and about comedy, just comedy in general, the general rules. Okay. And you even said, no, it's not fucked up to apologize once in a while
if
you go too far with something. And I actually, Buck was a thing where I was like, yeah, I was really fucking off on that.
No, I don't. Of course, I think what was that thing for a while? I never apologize. It's like, dude, of course you apologize. You're never gonna grow as a person or as a comedian if you gotta know if you went too far. If you believe that or feel that, then then you can say I'm sorry. Oh, with especially a human being.
Unless you truly believe you're not wrong, I guess. You know, at that point, then you know what are you gonna do? But
you know who doesn't apologize?
I know a few guys that don't apologize.
There's a couple.
Quite a few.
Have never done a mistake in their lives. Wowie.
Yeah. Who are you going to say there?
Well, Dawn.
Dawn?
She's very rarely will she come up and say, I'm sorry. And if she does, it's with a tone. Women have tone issues, right, Christine?
I do.
Huh?
I do.
Oh, you definitely have tone
Dawn,
issues.
Dawn will also not, like if she thinks you're being ridiculous about apologizing to her, will kind of shut it down.
Oh, yeah, she does. She doesn't like weak men.
I've been overly apologetic to Dawn, and she's like hung up on me.
Yeah.
Because I'm literally just trying to be like, Dawn, you're so great. Like, I'm sorry. Like, if I offended
you. She doesn't like weak men.
Yeah.
Yeah, she doesn't like that.
No.
She doesn't like when I get sick. Get up. I go. Get up and go. Yeah, but I'm yeah, no, you can get up. You can do it. You got it. Yeah, she doesn't like that.
Sucks.
Yep.
That sucks.
Yeah, she is not a...
I wouldn't like that. I wouldn't enjoy that at all.
I don't like it. You can't have everything you want, but she is super strong in everything else. But when you show weakness, she hates it.
Okay.
She doesn't want it at all because she doesn't get sick. When she gets sick, she just goes. I'm like, relax. Then she's like, no, gotta get up.
I want to talk to you.
Oh, Jesus.
Speaking
Christ.
Of weakness, this was my criticism of your happiness. Remember?
I do remember. I thought we were going to get through the show. We're almost there.
This is
good.
Is
there a break? No, we good.
This is,
we got time for this.
Oh, good. Thanks,
this
Lou.
Is good.
Appreciate it. Thanks for backing me up, baby.
This is good. This is really good.
Can you write on a sign, big leggers, go fuck yourself?
I'm very... Now, you've gone through a physical transformation. You're going through a physical transformation.
I don't like where this is going on. No, because you're calling it a physical transformation, and I don't like that.
What else would I call it?
I don't know. I lost some weight.
You're going through a lessening. Let's put it that way.
I don't like that either.
You're lessening.
I don't like it.
You're shrinking.
I don't like that either.
Yeah, I know. I'm saying you're going through a big... I say it as physical transformation because I think it's more. There's more to it than weight loss. I think it has a great effect on every part of your being.
Okay.
I'm actually saying that very out of high respect.
Mm-hmm. I know.
And I know I've seen a shift in your energy. You've become incredibly positive.
Are your headphones on?
Yeah.
Because I know you.
Yeah.
I know where this is going.
Yeah.
I know that you're buttering me up.
No, and, I'm not. It's
and
not
something's
gonna,
coming.
It's not to pull the rug out, mm-hmm. but it is to go to a criticism.
Okay.
Here's my problem.
Mm-hmm. That I'm happy.
No, I like that you're happy. But your happiness is getting in the way of something. You're doing everything you need to do for yourself, and you're bettering yourself.
Yep.
You've lost your touch with food completely because you recommended two places to me on the road that you said were amazing, and they fucking stunk. And I was like, this kid has lost his touch. He's lost his fucking touch. Like when Miles Davis got sober and then his music sucked. And I was like, I'm glad he's not on heroin, I guess, but the music, you lost your touch.
Wait,
it's gone.
You're out of your mind. First of all, you're out of your mind. Tell me the restaurants that
take,
I gave.
I need you to take the note on this.
Okay.
Brother, you sent me to a coffee shop in Louisiana.
Mm-hmm.
Bob, you're better than this. You're better than this place. This place was like a coffee shop that you would find like in the suburbs, in the most boring suburb shopping mall ever, like strip mall. Where you would go like in a pinch, and I know you. 5 years ago, I would have brought you into this fucking place, mm-hmm. and you would have been like, "Come on, dude, what the fuck are we doing here?"
Okay, I'm gonna say something to
what
you
are
right
we doing
now.
Here?
I'm gonna admit something to you right now.
Yeah,
with coffee, I'm gonna say something.
Put those hands down, please, please.
I'm gonna say something to you right. Can I have one hand?
Yeah, yeah.
I'm gonna say something to you right
yes.
now. With coffee.
Yes.
I have changed my whole game up. I get one thing once a day. It's the same thing every time. It's a quad espresso, a little bit of cream, and a stevia or a sweetener.
Great.
So anywhere you go, this is why I did it. Because coffee shops are different. Every coffee place is different when you get the regular coffee, right? But when you get an espresso, a quad espresso, it's the same everywhere you go. A quad espresso at a shit place... At Dunkin' Donuts, at this, is the same. It's four espresso shots with ice. Well,
there are quality levels in espresso.
I'm saying pretty much the same. So
sure.
I might be off my game in that. But here's the thing. So I'm looking at it from my perspective now, where it's a quad espresso. Yes. It is not the, you know. But how about this? Can I say something? Can I give you a little thing back? Can I throw?
But that wasn't the quad espresso. Wasn't the problem?
Okay. Well, you said the coffee shop.
Yeah. And the reason you said that coffee shop, you go, pastry is going to blow your mind.
I did not say that.
Yes, you did.
I did not.
And I walked in and I go, Bob, this is a chain coffee place down
fucking,
here.
You're crazy.
I'm not crazy.
No, you're nuts. That hat, take the hat off. I was wondering why you were wearing a hat, because you got brain surgery. You have a fucking bandage under that hat.
No,
that,
you didn't eat the pastries. You just told me that it had a great selection of pastries.
I did not.
Yes, you did.
I said the chicks were hot.
No, you said the Mexican trans woman.
That was Starbucks.
At the Starbucks.
That was Starbucks.
Was hot.
Oh my god! I almost left.
And I almost hoofed it down there to see.
Dude, I almost took an Uber through the drive-thru to go back to her. Oh my god, was she the hottest girl ever? Oh. All right, listen. Oh, we have to take a break. I'm reading that off a huge sign. Break from Lou. Thank you so much. It's been a great show. I've had a great time.
Is this the end?
Almost. We'll be back in a couple of minutes. Make sure you check out Joe DeRosa. Show starting Thursday, March 30th, Hamtramck, Michigan, Grand Rapids, Chicago, Batavia, Illinois, through April 2nd. Go to joederosainfo.com. He is one of the funniest guys walking, so you want to check out these rooms. And they're going to sell out. And, of course, Big J Okerson, holy shit, Dog Belly, premieres April 5th. His new special for free, youtube.com/@BigJOkerson. We'll be right back with The Bonfire.
And now back to The Bonfire with Big J Okerson and Robert Kelly.
It might seem crazy what I'm about to say. Sunshine, she's here, you can take a break. I'm a hot air balloon that could go to space.
Something happened, but we're back at the bonfire. Can you hear me? Can anybody hear me?
I think I'm back. The wrong there we headphones.
Go. Oh, I had the wrong headphones. Hey, listen, we gotta fuck things up.
I was wondering why you didn't come in.
I got all the. I gotta make sure Lou's doing something over there. You know what I mean? Thanks, Lou. Appreciate it, man.
Want me to make a sign?
Dude, we gotta make a big sign. Your headphones. Such an asshole.
Jay does it all the time. Don't worry.
What a perfect show. We were great. Everything was awesome. I said Faction 103, Sirius XM, Big J Okerson and Robert Kelly, The Bonfire. We're back. What a great. I'm happy, Joe.
Good.
I'm happy.
Good.
I'm happy, and there you go.
That's great.
And you know what? You're right. You're right about the food. I have lost it, and that's okay, because I'm thin now, so it's all on you. I give the food, the vagina, everything over to you.
How much did you lose?
I lost a middle-aged woman, around 140.
Wow.
130.
Are you at your goal weight?
No, not at all. Not at all. I got maybe 20 more pounds.
That's
and then fluctuate from there.
Close, dude.
I mean, yeah, it was pretty close. Jeez. I feel fantastic. I mean, I'm totally great. I'm everything I want to buy for clothes is just gay. All there was just tigers and lions and unicorns. I just wore gay clothes.
It's like Ed Hardy style.
Do you remember when I lost weight the first time in 2008? And remember I went into that store and I bought the pants with the unicorns and the tassels? The jeans?
No.
You remember that gay store on 47th Street near the Starbucks?
Anyways. Oh, no, I remember the store. It was across from my apartment. I don't remember you buying those. Oh, that's so funny, though.
Dude, I bought unicorn jeans. Anyways, see you guys next week. Enjoy the show. Big J, April 5th. Make sure you check him out. YouTube.com/BigJOkerson. And Joe DeRosa, info.com for his big tour going through Michigan, Illinois, Chicago. Check him out at RobertKellyLive.com. Love you guys. Crackle, crackle. We'll see you tomorrow.